Hey everyone, welcome to Night to Shine. This is our favorite night of the year, and not just because it's so much fun with the dancing and the lights and all that, but this is our favorite night of the year because this is a night where this community of individuals with special needs gets to know that they are loved, that they are valued, and that they are sons and daughters of the King.
Isn't that beautiful? You just saw a glimpse into what took place this past Friday night at our Grace Warwick campus, a night to shine, and just a beautiful community that came together. We had limos, we had red carpet, we had paparazzi, we had hairstylists, we had shoe shiners, we had it all. And it was a beautiful, beautiful night. So I want to give great thanks to God, of course, for how he uses his church to love our community. I love our church, that we get to serve our community in such sweet ways. As also a special thanks to Pastor Brandon Brown for his leadership, terrific leadership over our event. Brandon, we appreciate you and your leadership. And also Pastor Brandon, oh yeah, give it up for Pastor Brandon here. Also grateful for his team, Cecilia DeSantis, Teresa Van Curen, Ishidar Garvey, and their leadership, and of course their teams with them and all of our volunteers. Thank you so much for giving of yourself. And also for giving financially. As you tithe and you give, we're able to do these kinds of events, so thank you so much. Well, we're in a series called Love That Lasts, and last week we talked about singleness and what to do with it as a teenager, even as a young adult, older adult. So if you're interested, go back and listen to that message. And now we're getting more into marriage world and excited about where we're headed over the next little while. It's going to be a challenging message, maybe a marriage vitamin for some, but it's always helpful for my marriage as well. So let's pray and we'll jump right in. Lord, thank you for all who are gathered, and now, Holy Spirit, we need you. Thank you for speaking through worship, and now we pray you would speak through your word and through your servant. Help us, we pray, in Jesus' name, amen. So in the Jones house, we have two dogs. We have first a 1,000-year-old Chihuahua we named Tidbit, but literally she, I think she's 18, going to be 19. And the world record, I think I heard, is that the oldest Chihuahua is around 23. So pray for us to break the record, right? I mean, hey, she's this far along, might as well go the distance. And we also have another dog, which is a boxer. He's like a living stuffed animal, y'all. If God had a dog, it'd be a boxer. I'm just saying, all right? I'm partial. His name is Gus, and he has this thing that whenever Christy and I sit on the couch and we're going to watch a show, he'll walk over in between us, and he'll put his paw in between us. Then he'll put his other paw in between us, and then he'll nuzzle his nose in between us. Then he gets up, and he wiggles his rear end in between us until he's right there fully vibing, right there in between us. And just this week, Chris and I went for this walk and took Gus with us, and he's running around being crazy. The minute we held hands, guess where he went? Right between us, right through the between. And I thought about that, and I thought about marriage. And I wanted to ask you the question, what or who has come between you and your spouse? What has put its paw in and is starting to inch its way between you, or two paws, or the nose? Or there's something in someone just right there right now in your marriage. Or maybe it's something that keeps running through. You feel you have victory over it to some degree, but it just keeps showing up in between you and your spouse. If you have anything, and we all do to a degree, I'm thankful you're here as we unpack that today. We're going to see God's intention and his design, his purpose for marriage, and how it's very important to be sure we are repentant of anything that can come between our spouses, our husbands and wives. So with that said, let me read this text, Genesis chapter 2. I want to see what God says about marriage, and then we'll get a little more practical from there. So this is Genesis 2, verse 18. Then the Lord God said, "It is not good for the man should be alone. I will make a helper fit for him." So we'll talk about helper and all of that here in the next couple weeks. The man gave names to all the livestock and to the birds of heaven, of the heavens, and to every beast of the field. But for Adam, there was not found a helper fit for him. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man. And while he slept, he took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman, and brought her to the man. Let me pause right here. It's such a beautiful moment. I love how, first of all, it doesn't say that God took from Adam's muscles. He took from Adam's bone, the deep penetrating part of Adam. And notice how it says that God brought her to the man. What a beautiful moment. God as father, protective over his daughter, taking his daughter and walking her down the aisle to the man. Verse 23, then the man said, "This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh, and she shall be called woman because she was taken out of man." And right there, we find the first recorded human words of history. The first human words. And the first human words are words of love, words of poetry even, a love song. And now we find that God has not only been like a father doting over his daughter, bringing his daughter down the aisle to the husband. We see God not only as father then, but now we see him as pastor. He's as if he's a pastor now officiating the wedding between man and woman, husband and wife. That's why it goes on to say, "Therefore a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh." And right there, we find marriage. Marriage is not a social construct. Marriage was not invented in the Stone Age to keep the tribe together and healthy. Marriage was dreamed up, invented by God, God himself. This means a lot to God. To be two chapters in, and we find the first recorded words of human beings, and it's around marriage between man and between woman, man and woman. God created marriage then, and all that is to come with it. Love, romance, friendship, sexual intimacy between man and woman for life. I love the thought that God invented marriage. That word invented is on purpose. So an invention, someone who invents something. When something is invented, the inventor has a set design and purpose for that which was invented. So for example, anybody going to the place where you get the manicure done, no one's going to walk, the lady's not going to walk out and crank up a chainsaw and go at it with your manicure, your pedicure. I forget which one's which the fingers, which the toes. You know what I'm saying. So they don't use a chainsaw. Fellas, when you go to get your hair cut at the barber, they don't crank up a weed whacker, all right, and go and stand back and try to. No, because that design and purpose goes against you. The design and purpose for the chainsaw and the weed whacker, it has to use it outside of its design and purpose, as I said, can go against you. So God has a design and a purpose for marriage. To go against his design and purpose for marriage means it can go against you. There can be relational fracture, broken heart, invented by God, design and purpose, one man, one woman, man and woman for life. That's his original design and his purpose. So let's read Genesis 2:24 again. We're just going to spend all of our time on this one verse. "Therefore a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh." That word, or that phrase, hold fast, that means to be glued to. It's actually a word which means to be legally bound. It's a covenant word. A covenant made in the Old Testament always had a legal nature to it, a signed on the dotted line nature to it. So it's biblical, and it's also a covenant in that it's legal. So it's a covenant. And Hebrews goes on to mention this interesting sentence about those who make a covenant with one another, and we'll apply it to marriage. "For where there is a covenant," Hebrews 9:16, "for where there is a covenant, there must of necessity be the death of the one who made it. So on the wedding day, the husband faces his wife and the wife faces her husband, and you're saying, I'm going to the death for you. I will die for you. And I don't just mean I will die to protect your life. It means I will die daily to my needs, to meet your needs. I'm not going to hold anything back. It's not what I can get out of you in this marriage. It's about what I can give to you in this marriage. You're saying, I covenant to meet all your needs, sexually, romantically, friendship, financially, all of me for all of you. This is my covenant to you. So therefore, that means as you go on about your marriage, you're saying, if we experience bankruptcy or disease or illness, I'm with you to the end. It's saying, if I meet someone more attractive, more interesting than you, I will turn from it because I'm with you to the end. If you don't meet my expectations or standards that I thought you would live up to, I'm still with you to the end. If, fellas, if she doesn't respect you in the way you feel you should be respected, or if, ladies, you're not loved in the way you feel you should be loved, you're married and you say, I'm with you to the end. It's also saying, if you lose your beauty, if you lose your handsomeness or your muscles or whatever it is, your appeal, if you lose your tenderness, your compassion, I'm still with you to the end. Welcome to marriage. Because you hear that and you go, I don't know about all that. Right? I get it. Me too. But that's the original design and purpose. And so we got to take what God says, not what culture says. Let's come back and just see, for what it's worth, what does he say about marriage? And we're all going to be deficient. We're all going to have struggles. But let's at least see what God has to say and work through it. So covenant, I want to come back to that word covenant. So covenant of marriage is wedding. The wedding takes place between a husband and a wife, or the fiancés. So they're coming together, and you got to be careful. I think I mentioned this last week. You got to be careful if you're single, and I've seen this happen, that you're more in love with your wedding day than you are with your marriage to come. That goes bad. That's not God's intention. So the wedding is about getting married and moving toward the future of a marriage. So that's where the covenant happens with the rings. It means a ring around us to never be broken before God and before others. Covenants of the Old Testament were made before God and with witnesses. So that's why, to show the covenant of love, we have the weddings before God and before witnesses. So in speaking of those witnesses, here's a way you need to think about weddings that you attend. When you go to someone's wedding, your very presence is saying one of two things, or saying two things, actually. The first thing you're saying is, I am here with my presence to say that this is a biblical marriage. And my presence here says that I believe God is in this marriage and that his blessing is upon this marriage. And I'm here to give glory to God and to be a blessing of God in my attendance. So that's one way. And the second way, and the way I've heard it put, is that invitation you received is actually an accountability invitation, which means by your very presence, you're saying, I am here to be a part of this wedding, to attend it. That way, if either one of you, once you're married, ever try to run out on the other, I'm going to show up on your doorstep and hold you accountable. I bet you won't ever go to a wedding again, will you? Because that's what we're saying when we're there. It's a big deal. That's why marriage is a big deal in God's eyes, that it would go this far. So the wedding is not about present love, it's about future love. Tim Keller puts it this way: marriage is making an appointment for yourself to be there in the future. So I'm setting up wedding and moving into marriage to say how it all points to marriage being the number one most powerful relationship in your life. It is to be number one, the number one priority. Now, when I say that, I mean on the earth. The ultimate priority is your relationship with Jesus Christ. He is to be, as we talk about it around here, the top button. If you have anything else buttoned there, everything is off. So he is to be the top button, Jesus Christ. When Chris and I did our vows with one another, our vows sounded something like this. I've shared this many times over the years. Christy would vow, she vowed, Jarrod, I promise to love Jesus more than I love you, so that I might love you when you deserve it, but especially when you don't. So that's where it all goes, husband and wife, to love the Lord Jesus. And then out of that flows the second button, or we'll say the top button on the earth, with your spouse. If there's anything that comes between you and your spouse before your spouse, the buttons there are all thrown off as well. It's the second, outside of Christ, it's the number one priority relationship in your life. To which you might say, well, isn't my child the number one priority in our family life? No, let me show you real quickly. Genesis 2:24. Therefore, a man shall leave his parents, his father and mother, and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. So if parent-child, if your child was to be the most important priority in your family, God would have never told anyone to leave their mother and father. No, the chief relationship is husband and wife, and then the buttons follow from there. So when you're married, and in your marriage, you're saying, I am responsible before God to protect you from anything that can come in between us, to give you chiefly my time, priority of my energy, and the priority of my resources to meet your needs and to protect our marriage. That's marriage. Now, the problem is pressures and demands and crises and life that can just happen in our marriages that can slowly have something put its paw in between you and your spouse, or its nose, or something altogether that becomes a fixture between you and your spouse. Now, what could those be? And what do you do about them? Let's talk about that. Before I jump into the big ones I think are there, let me mention a couple that I didn't get into. I'm reading this book right now. It's a memoir of an Auschwitz survivor by the name of, she's a doctor now, Dr. Eva, I never get her name right, Dr. Edith Eva Eger. So she's an Auschwitz survivor. She's 95 years old, licensed counselor and therapist. She meets with soldiers who have gone through PTSD, but she also does marriage counseling. And in her writings, in her memoir, she says she sees, I'll just take the first two. She says she sees the top two things in marriages that are problems, sexual intimacy and finances. And she doesn't really unpack that, but I get what she's saying. So I'm not covering those, but let me mention them in passing because they are deeply important that could truly bring issues in your marriage. Sexual intimacy and all things around that. It can be devastating in a marriage, disappointing in a marriage, frustrating in a marriage with issues around it. So let me say, don't be ashamed of that if that's a battle in your marriage. There's nothing to be ashamed of. You're human beings. You're married. You're both sinners, right? That these things happen. So let me encourage you. Listen to the podcasts about these issues. Read the books. Read the blog posts. There's so much out there that can help you and serve you. And of course, we have marriage mentors here at Grace that might can serve you in that way. There's professional counseling that we can offer you here at Grace as well to really work on that from being in between you and your spouse. And secondly, finances. Huge issue. Finances. Again, there are books and there are resources, there's podcasts, there's blog posts. We offer financial peace here at Grace Community to help you get out of debt and navigate that better. So those are big issues that can come in between. But I want to spend the rest of our time on other big issues that can come between, especially in all my years of pastoring and ministry. And here's a big one I'll start with. Parents. Parents can come in between a husband and a wife. Now, if you're here and you're like, well, I've been married 25, 50 years. My parents are long gone. Oh, well, hold up, because your parents can be long gone, but still have something going on inside of you that can still show up in between you and your spouse in your marriage. So Genesis 2:24, let's read it again. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother, wife shall leave her father and mother as well, and hold fast to his wife, hold fast to her husband, and they shall become one flesh. So notice how he starts with parents. You leave it to enter into a whole new identity. You're no longer child. You are married. You are a spouse, brand new. You're a brand new person. You're a brand new identity. It's that important to really take that in. And he says you got to leave. You got to leave your parents. Parents guide, mold, shape children. Now you enter into your marriage, and now your marriage has that kind of power to mold, shape, guide you as well. So this whole identity that's taken on by leaving mother and father. Here are some thoughts about how, if you're married, you haven't left your mother and father. You maybe haven't left your mother and father psychologically, emotionally. In other words, you could still be carrying anger or bitterness or brokenness that happened in your family. Even years later, parents passed away, but there's still something in you, and you know it's in you because your spouse triggers it in you. And your marriage can bring out the best in you, and it can bring out the worst in you. And anything you got tucked down and buried, oh, it will show up. You know, if you're married, you know exactly. I'm surprised I haven't got any more amens yet, because I'd be amening that. It's just, it is what it is. And so maybe you're still psychologically, emotionally connected to your parent in these ways. Secondly, you can be financially still connected to your parents. If you're younger or even older, you haven't financially left your parents yet. So in your marriage, you really lean into your parents' financial support or meeting financial needs. Now, don't get me wrong. I love when parents help their kids financially for a season or for a tough spot or give gifts financially. That's beautiful. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about a couple who leans in, depends on, hopes for financial, ongoing financial support from their parents. That means you haven't left yet. Another one could be that you may care more about what your parents think than what your spouse thinks. And you feel like you need to get permission from your parents to even do things with your spouse, to move away, to take a new job. It's more than just asking for counsel. Let's know there's something you feel you need their permission, their input for, instead of you and your spouse making the decision on your own as a new identity, as a family. And then this is probably one of the bigger ones for me, and it's that you would share issues about your spouse, complaints, to your parents. Oh, don't do that. First of all, your poor parents having to bear that burden because they love you. And by the way, they're not objective either. You're their baby. They're going to be watching you. And their spouse, okay, they're looking to you. So they're not going to have an objective view if you do that. And here's the most painful part of it. Say that there's issues and brokenness and complaints about your spouse and how they are and what they do and what they don't do to your parents. And then let's say God does something special in your marriage and you both heal. Your parents are involved in the healing. So now they have this ongoing impression of your spouse that you can never really take away. So that's why we're having a message series like this. I wish I'd have heard this as a teenager and a young adult and even as a married person. Maybe this helps to navigate. I'll tell you why this was big. When Christy and I got married, my old youth pastor back in the day married us. He did a little sermonette in our marriage, and we had no idea what he would preach on in that little sermonette. But he said this, and it struck me, and I've never forgotten it. He said to the both of us, never share your issues outside your marriage to your parents, because to do so would be like being a traitor to your spouse. And I'm telling you, it's something Christy and I have really sought to live by for the good of our marriage. So if there are issues, leave your parents. There are pastors here at Grace that can be objective to help you through these things as a couple. There's professional therapists we would recommend that you could go see together that will be objective and help you through these things. Are you with me? So be careful that you haven't left your parents emotionally, psychologically, financially. A second reality that can come between you and your spouse are children. Our children. Think of the Garden of Eden. Who did God create? He created Adam and Eve. He did not create Adam and Adam Jr. Adam and Eve, man and woman, that's the family. People get the impression, no, family is me, my spouse, and maybe a child or two. Nope. The family began in Genesis 2, and the family is husband, wife, man and woman, and that's it. Children are additions. It's about husband, wife in the very beginning, and how children are not to be the top button. anywhere near the top button. I mean, they can be the third button, but the chief button is between you and your spouse. For kids to get in between intimacy, between your affections and emotional needs, get in between you and your spouse, goes against God's design and purpose, and therefore that design and purpose will go against you. And how healthy is it for your children if your spouse is first in your family? It just overflows to a greater health to your children. So you need to leave your children. Now, here's what I mean. Let me say it in a roundabout way. If you are going to your children to find your emotional needs met because you feel like your husband is not meeting them, and so you go to your children to have those needs met, or psychological needs, instead of finding them in your husband or seeking to keep yourself open, you go to your kids. Or affection. If you're not getting the affection you want, so you go to your kids for all that affection. That means you haven't left your kids. You got to leave your kids in a sense that you only take those needs and reserve them for your spouse and not find them through your children. In that way, if you're doing that, that's what another writer called your children being like a surrogate spouse. You're looking to them to fulfill you in ways that's unhealthy for your marriage and unhealthy for them as well. So think about that. If you're married and married for years, decades, and we're facing this as a family right now, our kids are growing up and they're about to head out to college here. And so we're going to have an empty nest in a sense. So think about if in your marriage, one of you or both of you have really sought to find your identity and affection and emotional needs met through your kids, and now your kids are gone? What do you have left as a husband and a wife other than a business partnership or your roommates? And that's not what God intended. So look within and say, have I allowed my children to come between me and my spouse in these ways in which I'm trying to find needs met? Another one that could come in between, this is a doozy, is friends of the opposite sex. Friends of the opposite sex. So upon wedding day and marriage, you are to leave friends of the opposite sex. They don't get your affection, your time, your energy, your resources. Matter of fact, you leave them in those ways completely. Relational and emotional intimacy is for your spouse only, not seeking to find those in some sideways way with someone else. It's no one is going to know you like your spouse. No one is going to be closer to you than your spouse. And you really got to fight for this, and you got to guard your heart from this, especially when your marriage gets rocky. Here are where the sirens blare. If you go to anyone outside of your marriage to the opposite sex and you talk about your marriage struggles, sirens, yeah? Or your dreams or your struggles or whatever that is, sirens everywhere. That's outside of God's design and purpose. That's only reserved for your spouse. So you need to watch those direct messages, those DMs on social media. If you're DMing back and forth with someone of the opposite sex and there's kind of this connection, you need to repent. You need to end it. And I would say not only that, but if you're caught up with following someone on social media and you're going and checking what they're doing and what they are and there's an attraction there, beware. Beware of going places and hoping you see her or hoping you see him who's not your spouse. Beware and do what I like to call put an emotional desk in front of you. When you sit down to go on the computer, there's an emotional desk between you. When you go to check your social media, emotional desk. When you go to ShopRite, emotional desk. When you go to work, emotional desk. When you go to church, emotional desk. No one can get near you emotionally, much less physically. And you live your life right like that. Because if you work with a lot of people of the opposite sex, I mean, there's a lot of temptation that could be there. So you got to put a desk there that no one can cross. And in so doing, you can keep that very dangerous friend of the opposite sex coming in between you and your spouse. And then finally, I'd say pursuits. Pursuits can come between you and your spouse. Career, education, technology, hobbies, even ministry. These are good things I just shared with you. Wonderful, wonderful things, gifts. But to be in their proper priority Even ministry shouldn't come before a husband and a wife, much less between a husband and a wife. So marriage is the top priority, and to neglect it, to neglect your marriage for other matters, can bring it to a place of disintegration. Let me read this again, Genesis 2:24. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. Notice that, one flesh. That's one body. You're a body now. Now, think about your physical body. If you neglect your physical body, you're slowly becoming unhealthy and dying. If you have a terrible diet, you can get away with it probably in your 20s and 30s. Or you can get away with it for a few years, but it will catch up to you. If you get poor sleep, if you're not doing any kind of exercising, your body is slowly deteriorating. So in the same way, if you neglect your marriage with pursuits, education, technology, career, and anything else that could go there, you may not feel the impact on your marriage the first year or the fifth year or the 10th year, maybe even not even the 20th year, but it's coming. There's a deterioration that is happening with anything you might leave in between or have in between you and your spouse. So these pursuits, some thoughts on this, is pursuits that you get preoccupied with. Like if you're so preoccupied with your career, finding your identity in it, it's in between you and your spouse. Or any other pursuit of your life, a hobby even, that can, or ministry, all of that has taken the wrong place in between. I had a former friend many, many years ago. He was in grad school, very involved in studying and writing papers and reading books all the time. He'd get up early and go study. He'd stay out late studying. He'd come home. Well, he was married. And one night he came home and there were just books in his bed. He'd moved, pulled the cover back. It was all his books. And there was a note left there by his wife as she was sleeping in another room. And the note said this: since you spend so much time with your books, you can sleep with them too. Uh-oh. So what might that be in your marriage? What are you spending so much time with that it's completely taken you over, preoccupied you, maybe even finding your worth and value and identity in it? I also came across this gorilla by the name of Amare. I forget what zoo he's in. Is in California. Anyway, he's obsessed with smartphones. He sits by the window when people are passing by, tapping on the window so people would show them their smartphone. And he'll sit there and stare at it. And there's a problem going on with him because he has completely neglected all his gorilla friends and his gorilla family because he's so obsessed with the smartphone. Ooh, let that be a sermon to us on all kinds of levels, but especially in terms of your spouse. If you find the phone and social media and all that engagement taking place of true communication and intimacy between you and your spouse, physically, emotionally, that's a red flag. It's a siren. That is in between. It's in between you and your spouse. So what's in between? Is it parents? Could it be children? Could it be friends of the opposite sex or pursuits or anything else I may not have mentioned? I can't go on and on and on for hours around this. But I want to bring it down now to the question of what do you do now? What do we do now? If we find something, someone's in between, what can we do? And it would be beautiful if both spouses hear this message and go, we can do this together. But even if it's just you that does it, it gives your marriage hope. Because if both of you say it can't be done, well, where's the hope for your marriage? But if just one of you can move in this direction, you've invited God into that struggle of your marriage. So let's go back to my lab. So we saw this last week. So last week we talked about if you were single and how God chiefly has all of us to find our worth, our identity, our pursuit, our life, our center in Christ Jesus alone. And so as you live your single life seeking him, growing in him, maturing in him, obeying him, look across from you and see who's on the journey beside you. Now let's take it to marriage. And the first thing we got to understand to deal with the in-between is to reorient yourself and myself to the design and purpose of marriage and what he meant for it to be. It's to see what God says about it, what he says about it ultimately, and how it applies to your spouse and you and my spouse and me. So for example, in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 31 and 32, this is Paul quoting Genesis 2, then he adds a bit to it. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I am talking about Christ and the church. So there's our model, Christ and the church. All marriages are to be commercials of what's to come. And that's the perfect union of we, the bride, his church, the people of God, with Jesus forever in a incomprehensible relationship with him forever. So notice what Jesus did for us, his bride. There was something in between us and Jesus. It's called sin. And so Jesus then, with this covenant we are to have before God, anyone who breaks the covenant is to die. We are the ones who broke the covenant. We deserve death, but Jesus, who didn't, died in our place. So he goes to the cross as the covenant breaker, taking on what's come between us and God, which is sin. He dies there, resurrected on the third day. Through faith in him, he has forgiven us for what we've allowed in between him and I and you and him and in the marriage. And now he ascended to the right hand of the Father where he reigns forever. What a beautiful picture of reorienting ourselves to the chief purpose of marriage in which Christ revealed to us. So in marriage, we realize there's sin that can come between our spouses and ourselves. And in so doing, we take on the initiative to forgive of that sin. And as that happens, hopefully with both, but at least for one, you are now taking measures of reorienting your life and your marriage to God's design, where you invite him into your marriage. So that's where you reorient first. And then secondly, repent. Repent. Repent meaning simply this: put marriage in its proper place, then put children in their proper place, or career in proper place, or hobbies in proper place. Put those in the proper place, and Christ be all, and then your marriage right under that as your chief priority. So watch, Ephesians 5:33. However, each one of you men, husbands, must love your wife as you love yourself, and wives must respect her husbands. So it's saying, I repent of how I have not loved my wife well by allowing something in between us. So I'm repenting of that. In repenting of that, I'm moving closer to God's design. And at the same time, removing what's in between, I'm growing closer to my spouse. So you're saying, I love my wife and I'm going to do this because it's God's design and out of my love. And then as the wife, I'm going to play the wife with the pink. Respect your husband. So you're saying, as I move toward my love of Christ, growing and maturing in him, I realize the scriptures say I should respect him. So whatever I've allowed in between us could be a disrespect to him. So I'm going to repent of that or put it in its proper order so that I'm moving toward Christ and repenting and then now finding myself closer to my husband in it. So here's a bit of homework, if you will, for the week. What if you and your spouse sat down and had a conversation about what's come in between us? Or what's got its paw there, at least? Or what's totally come in between us? Listen, that conversation might be a bit cringe. It might be a bit awkward. Probably going to be exhausting. It's going to challenge your ego, pride, but you're inviting God into it. And I get if you're all in, but your spouse may not be all in. At least you are making turns and angles to do what God would have you do, and that inviting his presence into your marriage, into your spouse's heart. And as you do this, as you have this conversation this week, even the possibility of the conversation, it's at least you making these steps toward Christ and drawing closer as you do with one another. And as you do, you will find God doing amazing work in you and creating in you and your marriage a love that lasts. Amen? Let's pray. Let's pray together. Lord, we rejoice that you love us enough to tell us the truth. We rejoice that you've showed us the truth in the person of Jesus. And Lord, this can be a very difficult message to hear for many. And I get it. I know that things are way more complex and complicated than just a simple message on these types of things. But Lord, you know those complexities. And I pray for your Holy Spirit to minister, to comfort, to give hope, to give strength, and to intervene, to bring hope and healing in this in-betweens of our marriages and of our lives. Jesus, thank you for your faithfulness to us to die on the cross as the covenant breaker on our behalf, for removing sin from in between us and God Almighty. Thank you for the forgiveness we find from you as well. And I pray all of that will root so deeply in our souls that it will overflow to our spouses and our marriages so that we indeed have your love in our love that will make it last. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. We all said, amen.
Amen.